Minnesota, how your beauty keeps a calling. What a tapestry of living lace. How your symphony of songbirds in those treetops charms. 10,000 lakes with sweet celestial grace. There's a real distinctive air of welcome in this land so fair and strong.
Hey there, and welcome to Source Song Festival's 2020 concert, Open Source. My name is Mark Bilyeu.
And I'm Clara Osowski, and we are the co-founders and co-directors of Source Song Festival.
While 2020 marks our 7th anniversary, in reality, Source started 8 years ago in an airplane over the Atlantic Ocean. Claire and I were in France, remember that?
Yeah.
We were studying French art song, and we came back to Minnesota thinking Minnesota is the place where an art song festival can thrive.
And last year, we showcased that thriving in Minnesota by highlighting 6 decades of our song tradition, all the way from composers who taught at the U to composers who have just moved here and composers who have moved away. So in this concert, we highlighted a song from each decade, and you will hear a lot of local singers, local pianists performing these works.
We loved this concert. We loved putting the concert together. And who else loved the concert was the Star Tribune, who said that it was Christmas come early.
So we'll see if you enjoy unwrapping your present this Christmas in August, our 7th year with Source Song Festival. And we're just so grateful to be a part of the song legacy in the state of Minnesota and across the world.
Then it's sure you've been a foretaste of that
We started the 1960s with a few songs by Paul Fettler entitled Belloc's Beasts, with texts by Hilaire Belloc.
Paul Fettler taught composition at the University of Minnesota in the 1960s and 70s, and we actually came across these manuscripts in the university library. After we found them, we took them to Canada, and Claire and I even performed them in France.
Paul Fettler taught a lot of our local composers, including Carol Barnett, Libby Larsen, some you might even hear tonight.
But before you hear those, you'll hear 3 songs from Belloc's Beasts. We have The Whale, The
Polar Bear.
Thank you, The Polar Bear, and The Frog.
And so please be kind and tender to the frog and enjoy the wit of these songs. Table fish. You cannot bake or boil him whole, nor serve him in a dish.
wants to be a don.
Claire and I were not yet born in the 70s, but luckily for us, the legacy of Prince is timeless.
We asked Liam Moore to arrange Prince's hit Baby from his premiere album, and Nora Long premiered this piece for us. And we hope you enjoy it so much that you're inspired even to sing along, or maybe make your percussion debut like Mark does in this recording.
Baby, what are we gonna do?
In the 1980s, the Schubert Club was already around for 100 years. So to celebrate their contribution to chamber music in the Twin Cities, they commissioned a song cycle by Juliana Hall, a student of Dominic Argento.
Juliana Hall remains a prolific composer of art songs, and we asked her to send us a little video to reflect on that process of the Schubert Club commission. Luckily for us, Pepper the dog joined the shoot.
Hi, Pepper.
I arrived in Minneapolis in 1987 to study with Dominic Argento, and I really enjoyed our work together very, very much. And it was soon after that that I received a commission from the Schubert Club shop called Night Dances. It was really neat because they sent me to Ravinia to hear Dawn sing because I didn't know her. We were both very young in our careers. And it was some of the most glorious singing I think I've ever heard. So I actually wrote the piece that summer, and Dawn and Margot Garrett did the premiere in the fall of 1987. And since then, many singers have been performing this piece. So it's been a remarkable beginning to my work and my career. And I'll always be thankful to the Schubert Club for this.
In the 1990s, we stay in Minnesota and celebrate one of our own composers, Libby Larsen. Libby, you wrote Perineo in 1992?
I did.
For?
For Will Parker. A very beloved singer, friend of mine, who also was the person who thought up and began the AIDS Quilt Songbook.
Well, I've seen the AIDS Quilt Songbook, part of it in person, in galleries, but I understand it was an incredible movement in the 90s.
It was. Of course, AIDS really blossomed in the 1980s.
Sure.
And several of us lost many, many good friends and family members and lovers and what have you.
Sure.
As a way of celebrating life, two movements were born. One was the AIDS Quilt
Wow.
Where family members, you know, or friends or whatever, would made a section of a quilt. But it wasn't just a section of a quilt. It was a section of a quilt,
yeah.
You know, and the AIDS quilt, when all the sections were sewn to it, would be brought to sites and then unrolled and would cover entire football fields.
Right.
Oh, it was extraordinary. Well, Will Parker, who himself succumbed to AIDS during the last years of battling AIDS, thought, why not have an AIDS quilt songbook? Where we begin with a number of songs, and then when that number of songs is brought together, as it was in a concert at Alice Tully Hall on July 4th.
Wow.
In 1992.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, that was the first concert.
History
of it.
Yeah, was made.
Oh, it was amazing. So that group of songs then spawned a national, international movement of other composers adding to the quilt of songs.
Well, it's clear to us in Minnesota why you would be chosen to be a part of it, but how did you get to be involved? Was it someone you knew, Will?
Or? Oh, yeah. Will was a very dear friend of mine.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the poetry was?
Roberto Echevarren,
okay.
Who was a very dear friend of Will's.
Wow.
So Will, I'd like to say, oh, it was so much fun, but it wasn't. There is a real responsibility and to bear the weight of sadness.
Sure.
So Will asked if I would set a particular poem, Perineo, by Roberto Echevarren, and could Will then premiere it as part of the AIDS quilt songbook at Alice Tully Hall?
Wow.
And we did.
And you say yes to things like that.
Of course you do.
And in your composition, how is it different than some of your other songs? Did you require different things of yourself, or...?
Yes. The poem is in both Spanish and English, and it flips back and forth.
Okay.
Which is brilliant.
Yeah.
Because, of course, our culture
flips
back and forth.
Yeah.
Yeah, especially between Spanish and English. I know Spanish, so that was not...
Great.
That was not the challenge.
Yeah.
The challenge was trying to understand... the Spanish and the English, what was the central image that needed to happen. And rather than it be the rhythm of English contrasted with the rhythm of Spanish, which it is in this piece, the central image is breath.
Wow.
Deep breathing.
Deep breathing.
And the contemplation of breathing, where you breathe from, what it means to be able to take... and unobstructed into your lungs, down to your toes, up through, a deep life-giving breath.
Yeah.
So that was, so when I thought, oh, yes, this is about breath, isn't it?
Yeah.
And being able to breathe.
And we saw the markings in your score that it requires of the singer to be visually taking different types of breaths.
Yes.
And that being a focal point. So this is why we decided to re-record in studio this piece specifically so we can provide a visual for what that central idea is.
I'm so glad we have the technology now,
yes.
That we really didn't have in 1992.
That's true.
But now we have the technology to hear the breath.
It's true. And it's a real testament that your song, even written in 1992, still... can be survived and motivated by the new technology. I think that's a hallmark that you've always done in your music, is that technology elevates everything you've ever done.
Thank you. Yeah, it's as evolving as music is.
Exactly.
At least in my lifetime.
Exactly.
It's never steady state.
Exactly. Well, thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us.
My pleasure.
We're thrilled to present Perineo by Libby Larsen.
No sé si soy hombre o mujer. Respiro desde la ingle, desde el perineo. Y me relajo. Ah,
liberty. I breathe in my trust from the perineum up into the center of my chest. Sing, and lo and behold, from behind a roar pumps up as a reward to those who breathe. It plays music, it passes through my nostrils, mouth shut. Respiro los tentáculos de Dios, la punta perdida de sus dedos por el perineo, donde las costuras todavía son recientes y los dedos juzgan que eres joven. Solar plexus, the tip of an indefinite sapphire pyramid, from under which a vortex comes up, a salty empire of a water banter. A panther. Aquatic tigress. A she-male breathing sapphire. I breathe my health. Respiro mino terminal enfermedad. From the base of my stomach, no sé si soy hombre o mujer, I relax the tissue underneath as it comes up a maelstrom of programming features for this continent which I am. Explota una cadena dentro de mi aliento. Y las abejas pican los labios abiertos de la espuma.
Now for our song from the 2000s, I have with me composer David Evan Thomas to talk about his song, A Blessing, which we featured in that 2019 concert. David, thanks for coming.
What a delight to be here.
We are delighted always to have you. Mm. Will you just talk about the song A Blessing and the larger cycle that it comes from?
A Blessing is the fourth song in a cycle of five by poems by James Wright. And the poem, A Blessing, which essentially gives the title to the set, is the best-known poem, probably Wright's best-known poem, too. And it's an absolutely lovely and perfectly American poem. So it seemed to be emblematic of the entire work, and I put it fourth, four out of five, the penultimate song, to sort of give it that primary place.
And so what about the poem itself is American? I know it references Rochester, Minnesota.
It does. In fact, the first line is, just off the highway to Rochester, Minnesota.
I've been there.
Yeah. Well, this is not the Destination Medical Center, Rochester. I mean, it is the same city, but since it's just off the highway on the way to, it's a rural location, and two men are visiting some horses. Mm. And so you're placed in the American heartland right away, and you're placed in the company of animals and intelligent ones. So you then, in the course of the poem, have a chance to interact with the animals. They, because they're breathing, you get the air from their nostrils. They ripple tensely. Wright is very vivid in his description.
Yeah, and I'd say even in the piece itself that you've created, I hear that rippling and that breathing. So
oh, marvelous!
Yeah, well done.
That's great. Well, as Michael Dennis Brown says, a poem is a series of imaginative decisions. And when a composer encounters a poem, the composer must also make imaginative decisions in response to the ones that the poet has made. So in a sense, what you're saying is that my imagination was interacting with James Wright's.
I love that. So I love that idea so much. Would you say that you often fall in line, your imagination falls in line with other poets, or is James Wright sort of a unique situation in that songwriting experience of yours?
No, it's not unique. I tend to choose poets that I'll respond to that way. I just finished writing a E.A. Robinson set where the characters are quite repressed and dour, and that seemed to appeal to my sensibility right now.
Sure. Well, I wouldn't necessarily call you dour, but fair enough. Fair enough. And so the poem is about Rochester, Minnesota, or being on the way to Rochester, and the cycle itself was premiered also in Minnesota. Is that right?
Yes, it was. It was part of a festival honoring James Wright when Wright's widow, Annie, gave the James Wright papers to the University of Minnesota. This was in 2000, and Michael Dennis Brown, who has taught at the University of Minnesota for many years, sort of used it as a chance to celebrate Wright's work, and part of that was commissioning a song cycle using his poems.
That's great.
And it was premiered then with Vern Sutton, tenor, and Sonia Thompson, and we premiered it at the Weissman. It really was quite festive.
That's great. So you mentioned Vern Sutton and Sonia Thompson, who are, of course, large players in our community here and proponents of art song. And, you know, Source is so proud to be a part of what we consider a long history and sort of looking backwards and forwards for what art song can be. And we so consider you a part of that, David. Mm-hmm. And we hope that you believe that about yourself. We want you to believe that about yourself.
I happily do.
Good. Good. I'd love to hear that. Would you maybe talk a little bit about what came before and after you?
Well, I certainly feel a part of the art song tradition. And for me, the art song tradition goes back to its beginnings. So it goes back to Schubert and Brahms and Wolff and include the French.
They never lived in Minnesota, though. Is that right?
As far as I know, no.
Okay, great. Just checking.
But in Minnesota, we have had composers writing songs here for a long time. There were a number of composers writing vocal music in the early part of the century. And then once Dominic Argento got here in 1958, he started writing songs as a major part of his output. And then I think because of that drew students who were interested in working with text as well. So after Dominic won the Pulitzer Prize in 1975 for a song cycle, and I may be wrong, it may have been the first song cycle to win a Pulitzer Prize.
I think it was.
Okay, from the Diary of Virginia Woolf. Mm-hmm. At that point, the word went out that here was a marvelous composer living in Minnesota, teaching at the University of Minnesota, and many other composers came. I was one of the later ones. I was one of his later students, so I only arrived in 1989.
Okay. This song, David, like all your others that we feature, is so beautiful, and we're so grateful to feature it again. Here we go.
2018, Source commissioned its MinSong alumni to write pieces to be premiered at OpenSource. Liam Moore wrote a piece called Winter in Construction for two singers and two pianists.
Although the title of the poem itself is called Driving Home from School in My Brother's Geo Metro by Marie Loom, Liam gave it the title of Minnesota's only two seasons, Winter and Construction.
And we really invite students to study at Source during the best week of the year that Minnesota has to offer, the first week of August. So please enjoy all these pictures of many Source seasons of the past. Maybe you can find yourself in some of the pictures.
And that's a wrap on our 2019 Open Source Concert, coming to you this year in 2020, right to your homes.
We're really grateful that you're joining us throughout the week, so please stay tuned for our concert on Wednesday and our announcement on Friday of this week. Or even drop us a line, visit our website, and find different ways to support us in 2020.
We hope this concert has proven to you that Minnesota is a place where art song lives and thrives. We're proud to be supporting that, and we're proud that you joined us in that endeavor.
Thank you from Source Song Festival.
Thanks.
Crazy horizon. Oh.